Getting the spirit in the dark. Getting the spirit. Getting it in the dark. Keep on moving. Oh, tell me, ain't we grooving? Getting the spirit, getting it in the dark.
This was in Memphis, Memphis, Tennessee, in the, like 1992. And so Dick Williams was in town to sign another band to Warner Brothers. He stopped by the studio to say hello to Nico. I was singing a jingle for Nico. He heard me, was like, hey, can she sit in with your band? I want to hear what she sounds like with the band. And they asked me, hey, can you sit in? I'm like, yeah, okay, well, tomorrow, okay, I'll sit in. And at that time, Saving All My Love for You was out, and Aretha's Who's Zoomin' Who was out, and, you know, Vanessa Williams and songs like that. So I went there to the club, and I sang my little Saving All My Love for You, all the Aretha stuff, and he was like, I can get you a record deal. I was like, yeah, okay, whatever. Because I had no interest. And I didn't think I was any good. That's the main thing. I didn't think I was any good. And I wish you joy and happiness. But above all this, I wish you love. And And 3 months later, he came back to Memphis and he had songs. And he said, okay, record these songs and then I'm going to get you a deal. I'm like, okay. But he did the best thing he could ever do was not ask me to sign anything because I wasn't. I didn't love it that much. I don't even know what we're talking about here. Let me see what's going on before I say yes. So I'm like, yeah, let's go on down this road. Let's see what happens. And literally, like a month later, there was a bidding war between EMI, Elektra, Warner Brothers. And because if you sounded like Whitney at that time, you're going to get picked up if you got a good manager. So we end up going with EMI. And Dick Williams had, worked with all these record companies through the years. But it's just a fluke how I got a record deal. And I was too stupid to even be nervous. I was totally unaware what was going on. Just didn't know, you know? But it saved me, I think, because then there weren't highs and lows. You know, high expectations. Because the record business, it's all a fluke. I was totally not in the now when I was signed. And things were, great opportunities were happening, things were going on, duets were happening, movies were coming, all this stuff was going on. And then when it ended in the late 90s, I almost didn't feel anything because I wasn't even really attached to that whole process. When I hear the song on the radio or, it was just foreign to me. It was just, cause it was something I hadn't had passion for. So it was just weirdly, like, I was totally detached. I was watching it from afar, and which was crazy, but I think it saved me. I really do. Because then once you in it, and then you want it so bad, then that's when you do anything for it and all that. And I knew I wasn't willing to do anything for success. So it was a good thing.
I cut whoever hires me, everything. Heavy metal, rock, funk, jazz, country, blues. The last three Buddy Guy records I sang on, I did here at the kitchen table. They both got Grammys. I didn't get nothing.
Now R-E-S-P-E-C-T, right now.
My dad was a pastor. He was non-denominational, but it was got holiness all in it. But before that, before that, we went to St. Stephen's Baptist Church when my dad was just a choir director, minister of music. And he was there, and we were there 4 days a week, at least, and all day on Sunday.
Don't go and talk about my father.
His message was always about the people. He was the one that taught us compassion, patience, love, respect. They never really cared what I did for a living. Like they were very proud. But when I go home and I was be with my family, we never talk about me doing music. Even when I had my records out, we never talk about it. I didn't want to. And they knew it. And I just wanted to just watch them laugh and let them talk and see what's going on with them. I still do it that way. I don't believe in settling, ever. Never have, my whole life. And I think that just came from, okay, I was child number five. So my parents had figured it out. They had worked everything out, the first four. They weren't sure but what kind of messages they wanted to send to their kids. By the time I was born, dream big, go, don't, you know, just, we got you. So settling was never an option. Now it's over, and this is the late 90s. What am I gonna do? Because I wanted to be a lawyer. I didn't gig like on my own or anything, so it's like, with your passion, it takes you other places. If you don't have the passion, the lights are off. I was getting out of my record contract because, you know, there are things I wanted to sing and the ways I wanted to sing, and they just wanted to keep me right there with Whitney. I mean, I couldn't get away from, and mind you, with Whitney, that's like, at that time, was the ultimate compliment. However, there's only one Whitney. You only need one. Anything after that is, you're gonna fail. So, but I take some responsibility for that because I didn't know who I was. I hadn't worked on my craft. I didn't even know I had a craft. So the fact that I didn't know who I was also, I would say, caused some confusion. I had to fight to get out. So I had to use my lawyers to get out of the contract. And then I had to decide, you know, what are you gonna do? And as I was deciding, my manager was looking for a new record deal. Julio Iglesias found me. He was looking for a duet partner. And I said, okay, I'll do this for like a year. I'll learn something from a living legend. And then I stayed 15 years.
Say yes, I confess. I've got more on my mind, 'cause I want more of you in your time.
A video, body and soul. Every girl I love you can express.
You changed my life. All the private planes, the islands.
I want everything and I'll take nothing less.
Seeing countries being born and things change and regimes change and talking to prime ministers of countries and presidents of countries. He was a great place to hide, to like and figure it out. I didn't think 15 years it would take that long, but it did. He had to let me go, because I wasn't leaving. 2011, he let me go, for sure, for good. But he taught me everything I need to know about passion for what I do, about my craft, and what's important, which is the people. He said, if you don't make that connection, then what are you doing? So after that was over, so I was spoiled at that point. And I was like, how am I going to make a living as a middle-aged woman in the music business? What am I going to do? And how am I going to make that kind of money? Then I started, some kind of way I got into the country music world through Becca Bramlett, who asked me to be a sub. So I got into country music and started going from one tour to the next to the next. In 2016, I got a call from Vince Gill. All the artists I've been fortunate to tour with, I was determined to maintain, stay on a certain level, and I was determined to learn something from every artist, because they're the icons, they're the ones with the staying power. You know, Martina McBride used to say a few times, you know, like, hey, I don't even want you out behind me. I don't tell any artists about my solo career, because it's not important, and I don't want nothing weird at all. So, you know, I was hired as a background singer, so I just maintained that. And then she found out, because that's just, she's a sleuth, so she wouldn't know who working for her. Okay, she's like, I don't even want you behind me. I said, listen, your money is paying for my dreams. I need to be here. I'm a realist. I'm great that you love me. I love you too, but I am a realist. I mean, she's the one been in the game over 20 years with 15 number ones. I don't have that. And I'm a realist. And may never in this climate, because it's a different market now, it's a different game.
I guess you need the laws to know you're up.
You know, it can get confusing when you are used to being out front. Sometimes you can't hide it in your face. I can, but some people can't, because they want to be out front. And my thing is, if I took the good gig to be back here, then I need to just maintain this. And as this really amazing musician told me, Rafa, he was Julio Iglesias' musical director for like 30 years till he died. He wrote a lot of Julio's hits. And he was like, I leave my ego at the house, because he's Spanish. He leaves his ego at home and then do the job at hand, but be amazing at it. So my track record is, you can always count on me. I'm dependable. You ain't got to worry about me not knowing my music. I mean, so my work ethic and listening. Then you got to listen to that artist and see what it is. How can you make that better without trying to overpower them? How can you be the pad? It's my goal. And that's what I've done, because I would want that. Yeah. On 2014 to 2016, I was on tour with Martina McBride, and I had made up my mind that I was ready to be a solo artist again. So I was like,
I'm gonna open up a checking account and I'm gonna put at least 50% of my income in this checking account. And I'm gonna be able to hire whoever I want. I don't know if it's gonna be jazz, pop, R&B, I don't know what it is, but I'm ready to be back out front. Martina McBride ended February 2016. March 2016, I was talking to Vince Gill and we were gonna go out on the road in April. So then I was having this conversation with Paul Franklin, still a guy, one of the best in the world. And I was telling him I had this idea for a project that I had gotten doing sound check one day when Vince was singing together again. And I started to ad-lib. I'm like, that's my record! Aretha meets country! Da-da! This venture I'm going on is not gonna be hard. I have no idea where I'm going. I have no idea how I'm gonna get there. But I see it. I see the kind of people I'm playing for. I see the message I want them to receive. I see, you know, I just see it. Is it superstardom? I don't know, because I've been around superstardom and I don't even know if that's something that I need. You know, on that hundreds of million dollar level. I don't know if I need that. I don't even know if I feel comfortable there. You know, this journey I've been on from recording artist to background singer, I'm back to recording artists coming up. And it was because I finally figured out where I wanted to be, how I wanted to sound. I didn't know what I wanted. So now that I know, I'm ready to go back out front. My past stuff was good, not great. That I can say that honestly. But I contributed to that because I didn't know who I was as a singer, artist, how I wanted to sound. Now I know I'm ready. Now I know how to do it. Now I know what's important. Now I know my purpose. And I'm ready.